Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about MLOps with TensorFlow. We will look at, or I will explain you how to run projects, and those projects are PySpark components. No? Those components are going to run in Dockers, and as we saw in previous videos where we were talking about projects, we will define the execution environment, our tracking environment in Databricks as in previous videos, and local environment for execution environment, and the code that we are going to run is specifically PySpark. In this case, PySpark, as you probably know, is the Python version of the Python library, similar to the Python, conventional Python that we run in our usually in our projects, but specifically prepared to work in distributed environment. PySpark is not more than a code, Python code that is running some classes or a number of classes that are ready to work in distributed environment and work with distributed objects like data frames, Spark data frames, or any other or algorithms like those that are in the Spark and mllib, the library which is also designed to work in distributed environment. The structure of the code in PySpark is similar, really similar, or practically identical to the code in Python, but obviously it's software that only works in Spark. It's not working in a conventional environment. And then if you work it in a conventional environment, you need to prepare your environment to this run. No, you need to install the library, you need to install Java in this case. As you probably know, Spark is built in Scala, and Scala is a variant of Java, and then we need a Java virtual machine, and the PySpark is an API to the Scala core in Spark. So everything under the hood is transforming from PySpark to Scala, and then on optimized and running in the core of the Spark. So as you can see, PySpark in terms of how it works is practically the same that Python. Instead, in fact, you can mix Python commands and Spark commands without any problem. At the end of the day, as you can see here, it's not more than importing a library by Spark. And as you can see here, PySpark had a class mllib, which is the machine learning implementation for distributed environments of Spark. No? It had classification algorithms, deep learning algorithms like Perceptron. Let's take a look, 1 second, Spark docs. If you look at here, API docs, Python, you probably know as well that we can write code in Spark in these five languages: Scala, Java, Python, and R. These Java, Python, R, and SQL are no more than APIs that allow you to write the code in those specific languages, and later the code is transformed to Scala. If you look at the PySpark, user git API reference, you see here what we had in PySpark, and among mllib we have transformers, we have probably it's not here, Spark SQL, my god, development. Every time I enter here, they move me everything. Okay, machine learning, here, Spark streaming, data frame base, MLlib. Okay, I wanted to check it if, well, this is the feature engineering, classification. We have GTT, random forest, multilayer perceptron, classification, training summary. Exactly, this didn't change too much. Classification model, classifier, clustering. We still don't have a deep learning algorithm for regression. Still not, we only have it for classification. Okay, well, but they incorporate a lot of stuff, transformers. This is new, but okay, take a look to the document to see what are included in the new release. We are going to work today with the new release, and as you can see here, the code that we are going to run inside the Docker is a PySpark. For those that are familiar with PySpark, well, what you see here is quite simple stuff. Here is the conventional creation of the Spark session, and behind everything that is working, this is how to say, interpreted by the driver and then sent to the optimizer and the transform scheduler. And all this stuff, how to say, what is in Python is directly executed on the driver, then on the rest is being executed. First of all, optimized by the driver, one of the components in the driver, and then sent to the different workers for execution, together with the data, obviously. So here, what we are doing is we are loading the Iris data frame. We load it in pandas format. We just rename here. You have it here. I just download it. This is very well known dataset used for benchmarking or to do baseline of any classifier. It's a multi-class classification problem. And here, once we read it, we just transform it into a Spark. We split it, and then we create the three components for our pipeline. And then we create a vector assembler. As you probably know, for those that are working in with PySpark, when you want to input a machine learning algorithm in Spark, you need to create a vector. It's slightly different to how we work in the conventional Python, that we just fit our algorithm with the pandas data frame, and then on every column is independent. Here, we just transform every row into a vector, and then this is the input of our machine learning algorithm. Here, what we are doing is creating the vector assembler, the object, with the data frame, and then we take all the columns except the latest one, which is label, which is our target. And then also something that is very common, particularly in how we view the transformation and the pipelines in Spark, we just simply nominate the name of the column, the name of the output of this step, and then the vector is going to be features. And then in the next step, that is going to be the scalar, standard scalar, is another class in PySpark. We just simply take the output of the previous step and use it as an input. And then on the output of the second step, the standard scalar is a scaled feature, and then we do the same here with the logistic regression algorithm. Logistic regression, as you know, is a classification algorithm, and here we are going to use it for a multi-class, three-class classification problem. They know we create the pipeline. The pipeline in this case is another object, another class in mlib, and the stages are sequentially, first of all the assembler, then on the scaler, and then on the loss. With this we just feed the model, the training model, and then on we do add a prediction with transform, and then we just select the features and predictions and show in the screen. Here there is two we do two different pipelines. One is a conventional sequential pipeline, and the other one is a nested pipeline. In some scenarios, it's better to group some of the steps together in a pipeline, and then on the output of that pipeline, group it with other components in another pipeline. And this is exactly what we are doing here. We group, assemble, and scale it in a pipeline, and then on this, the output of this pipeline is included in a second pipeline, which group them with the logistic regression algorithm. To my advice, if you don't have to say control very well how under the hood Spark make all the transformations and work and create the DAG, it's better to do the sequential pipeline. This is true that in some cases speed up the transformations, and this case that you configure it correctly, it will work faster, but you need to know how to do this. This is pretty simple scenario, and then on this there is no transformations at all, just scaling and creating the virtual, but this can be very complex, and if you don't know really how it works PySpark under the hood, it's better to do it simply sequentially. In any case, in this problem, it's not going to have really too much effect. The only thing is that you have the option, you can do just simply a sequential one or create nested structures to group the different steps, the different components of the pipeline according to your needs. And then on here, as you can see, we are using the PySpark flavor in MLflow, so an autolog. This means that everything that is inside the blocks of MLflow install room will be locked to our MLflow infrastructure. And then on here, the execution is going to happen in our environment. This means that I don't know. Yeah, exactly. This will work in our Docker desktop infrastructure. So I'm creating a Docker file. This Docker file is just pulling a version, an image I found in Docker Hub, which contain PySpark. In any case, the PySpark I upgraded to, I just did it just to avoid to set up the Java and all the dependencies. I just download one with this, even with Jupyter, but I just use it as a base and install whatever I need to run my Docker. So I even upgrade here the version of PySpark, and I set up the environment, the Java home environment, to the right path where the Java is in this image. I set up a working din and I copy all the py files inside the working din. What more? This is in terms of the Docker file. So we just create we build the image. If you had the Docker plugin here on my left, here where I'm pointing the, you can do it directly here, just right button, build image, you get the name and the tag, and that's it. This is going to create the image. You don't have any problem. Here is going to be very quickly, because I already have it done from my previous video. It's not, you can execute Docker, build Docker, not Docker, Docker build Young, young, hyper, hyper pool, hyper, hyper rm, hyper f docker file, and hyper t with the name of the in this case is Emmerflow latest. It had to be the same that you specify here, and semicolon latest, and here the scope of the software that you want to buy, you want to copy inside your where is located the software. No, you execute this and it's gonna be exactly the same that you have before. Yeah, you see it's very quickly. So this means that we have our Docker image is gonna be here in images. So I have plenty of them. Multiple tests, I will delete everything I don't need. Just to save some space. And now we return here. We are going to run in another window the code. So to run the code, let me show you. Probably I will do a little bit this. I want to use to see that our image Docker image appears and disappears. So now here I'm in the directory PySpar where I have the software, my ML project. So I will run MLflow run that. That why? Because the ML project is in this folder in PySpar. And then when I provide a name, a experiment name, remember that we are working in Databricks. So you need to create a experiment name in this format, slash your email address and slash the name of the experiment. Let's write it down here. And to log, if you don't specify ML tracking URI, MLflow tracking URI, everything will be locked locally. If you specify HTTP dot slash slash 127.0.0.1 semicolon 5000, you will be logging to your local infrastructure. Like in my case, if you already watched my previous video, I had a MLflow in Docker containers. You can see here. This custom, probably we can extend it here, is the MLflow tracker with a MySQL and with PHP admin. Let me show you. And if you want to log into Databricks, you had to use MLflow export the variables. Either in this is for Unix. If you are in Windows, you just had to put it in your environmental variables, MLflow tracking URI equal Databricks, ML Databricks host, this is the host of your Databricks. For those didn't show my previous videos, if you go here to your Databricks, this is the URI, the URL, workspace URL. This URL is one, it will depend on the cloud provider that you are using. It's gonna be different. Take into account that this is done, is in this workspace in is in Azure. If you are working in Google Cloud or in Amazon, it's going to be different. And you need as well the Databricks token. You need to export these variables. And then once you have it, let's return to the here. So we have here, and yeah, we simply MLflow run, and then we run the software. So you can see here probably. Oops. Here we have it. Let me show you. You have it here. Bash. And then on, this is our Docker. Okay. And now let's check if this working there. Python, this is a 3.11, import PySpark. You see here is already doing some transformations. But those are familiar with Spark. This is the typical Spark transformation. And then PySpark that version. Here we have ahí son problem 351. Quit. Which PySpark. So I think we can execute this. If you execute PySpark, you will see here the shell or PySpark. So for those that now you can hear SC, I think is. You have here the Spark context. Okay. And now you are looking at here. We already had, they are doing the transformations. And then once finished, the Docker disappears. This is essentially the base of the fundamentals of serverless technology. You just create the Docker, you use it, the Docker is destroyed when the job is done. Exactly the same that many of the technologies that you are using today in the cloud. Now let me show you what we got in MLflow. We are in the project here. It's not that. So what's going on here? Exactly, I named it. Sorry, Python 3. So we had the first, let me remind you 1 second. This is PySpark. If you look at the pipeline, we had first of all the non-nested pipeline. And here the nested pipeline is the second one. If we look at what we have here. So this is the first. If you go to the experiments, you have here the stages. This is the non-nested pipeline. You have the model here, the stages. This is your pipeline and the model is here. You have the metadata, what you need to deploy this model anywhere. You have the requirements. In terms of Conda, in terms of Python environment, in terms of requirements txt, and here the overview. We have autolock. We just lock all the parameters, and that's it. If we look at the second experiment, we will have the nested pipeline. You see here we have two pipelines here. If you look at the components, we just had two components. One is the nested. If you click on the nested stages, you have the other two. And exactly the same. And now we can register the model if you want. And the only thing I wanted to show you is how easy is to work with MLflow to deploy a model to run anywhere. Just we need to prepare our software, prepare the code and with two simple files. We create Dockers, we create Conda environments, we create depending how you are going to deploy the application, the model, everything working in combination with the installation of the MLflow. You can do either integrated with Databricks, you can do it integrated with your local environment, with any in a corporate deployment of TensorFlow. The only thing that you need to point to the right place. Many people is just using the Databricks as a central point of logging everything, and then on later you can even serve the models here in Databricks. We will look at this as well. Just take a model from the model registry and serve it here, and it's going to prepare as well according to what you have in your metadata here. It will prepare here simply a container as we did it here, and we deploy it will deploy the model into the serving server, the MFlow serving model, sorry, serving model, and it will start to do inference. And it's quite simple to creating serving endpoint. You can take here a model endpoint, Iris, for example. You can entity Iris PySpark and scale small, medium. You can see it's just preparing the infrastructure, scale zero, advanced configuration. If you want to add some environment variables, and again here you can add another server entity. You want to how to say you add another server entity, you can split the traffic in between. If you watch some of the videos that we had on the channel where we were using Azure Machine Learning Studio or Vertex AI, you see that this is exactly the same that we have in other technologies. We will look at this in a separate video because I wanted to show you how it works in Databricks, or also you can deploy these models to Azure Machine Learning Studio, to SageMaker, to a third party machine learning inference servers, where we will look at this. It's also some extensive material. We need to look at this in a different video. The question here is see how we can work with any technology. You saw already, probably we have already in this series 10 different videos. We work with time series algorithms, SkyTitan, Prophet. We work with Transformer. We work with deep learning. We work with SkyTitan. We work with Dockers. In Dockers with PySpark, without PySpark, it's also pending is also possible to deploy in the Dockers into Kubernetes. You can execute locally, you can execute remotely in another infrastructure. This that we have, if you have you can just execute the Docker into a container service in your cloud provider. So it's very, very flexible, the possibilities we have to deploy, to run any kind of job or components, any combination, pipelines, state, everything that you can deploy locally and run it and deploy it anywhere. The only nexo in between the different components is MFlow, which is facilitating that work with multiple technologies, LLMs, transformers, deep learning, machine learning algorithms, NLP, time series, whatever you have, is possible to be integrated. And if you remember as well, we create our custom PY models, which is something that is not already integrated completely with MFlow. You can create a custom class, with PY model and run it as well inside the Ember Front infrastructure. And well, that's all. I hope you get this point. Thank you for watching my video. Thanks as well for to hear up to the end. And as I used to say, subscribe, give me a like if you like the video and you find it interesting and useful for your job. And subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Share with your friends and colleagues in order to help me to promote the channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon.